This is Hacking the Afterlife podcast with Jennifer Schaefer. Jennifer!
Hi, Richard.
How are you?
I am fabulous.
Well,
I'm actually doing really well. I have just a couple more days before I'm off until to all those places.
Yeah, that's right, until you're off on your extended vacation. So we won't be seeing you for whatever, a couple of weeks, right? So
no, I hope
this we did.
We did, but I do believe we'll squeeze some more in. I'll take an afternoon off of diving and scuba diving for my birthday week.
You know, I think we should try to do a scuba diving session if we could. You know, why not? You're underwater. I'm in etheric space here.
Do you want to talk about the submarine a little bit?
Sure, absolutely. Gosh, it's been only a few days since, you know, that happened, and what a tragedy. Tell us, I'm sure people must have called you about it.
They did. My agents did early on. And I actually got the word imploding, and I didn't want to be right, because I'm on these cases, on situations like this, you never want to have that happen, right? Ever. And so when I was getting that, like, it literally broke in half and combusted, like it imploded and they all died on impact. That was, I mean, if you had to die, that would be a better, I don't know, if not that you had to die.
A faster way to go, yeah, than... Well, you know, the families were all concerned about their breathing.
They knew beforehand, but they had to do their due diligence to make sure, you know, but it was very, you know, I don't get any feedback. So whether my agents knew before that or whatever, it didn't matter. They're like, you were absolutely right, you know, when it came out in the news a couple days later. But it was just... it's still such a sad event. And then we have Russia, everything that's going on with Russia right now, which is very...
Yeah, the world is, stirred up. And for those joining us on our podcast, Hacking the Afterlife, want to welcome them. Driving in their car, be careful. Watch where you're going. And those tuning in for the first or the last time, we're happy to help talk about the process of talking to loved ones on the other side. And... in that vein, we have our friend Luana Anders on the flip side, who helps us navigate this class. And, you know, I always ask, so Lou, that's her name, Luana, anders.com. And Luana, is there anyone that you want to bring forward today that we can talk about or talk with?
Billy Paxton. Notice how I got his name right off the bat.
That's right, after forgetting his name a couple of weeks ago.
And he just asked. He's like Billy Paxton.
That's right. Funny. What do you want to say, Bill? You're always welcome here. We're always happy to talk to you.
Okay. Right. He's showing me the submarine. And then he's also showing me James Cameron, who also came out and said the same thing, based upon his knowledge and, you know.
Expertise, yeah, he's an expert in that field, for sure.
There's something about air being in a tank that exploded. Like, I don't know. He's trying to show me how it exploded.
He's showing you the process. I know that Jim Cameron had mentioned that the sub wasn't certified and that they hadn't gone through all the proper testing. And he pointed out the irony of being looking at the Titanic when the captain of that ship did this thing of charging into a moonless night in a sea of icebergs without sort of realizing that that was a mistake. And he likened the choices that were made to send this submarine down to be equal to that. But Bill, so what do you want? What's your impression of talking to us, or what do you want to talk about? Is that what you want to talk about?
He's saying there's people dying everywhere from all sorts of different things. You know, like, you do your best to keep your kids safe. You try to keep yourself safe. It's like that just definitely wasn't the right decision.
People make mistakes all the time on the planet. And without, you know, it's sometimes Jennifer and I will directly try to talk to people involved in an incident. And in this case, it doesn't seem like the right thing to do because their family's not asking Jennifer to, and they can. But Bill, let's talk about you for a moment here. Here you are stopping by to visit us. What's it like for you?
So what he said, he goes, here, I was doing something to help me and still died.
Right.
I'm so sorry, audience. I didn't finish the rest of what he was saying. He's like, yeah, that was unsafe, but we do our best to keep ourselves alive. But even then, I was trying to keep myself alive by going into surgery. And then that happened. He's like, maybe it's the luck of the draw. Maybe it's the, you know, maybe it could have not happened. Again, we have to get out of judgment in every way. But
well, I was writing about this yesterday on my blog, richmartini.com, which was about the way we talk about death. We have this thing, you know, so-and-so dead at age blah. And since this research demonstrates, and quite a bit of research demonstrates, consciousness is not confined to the brain, the idea of saying these things, we need a new language. So Elvis has left the building. You say so-and-so has left, and then we can talk about their accomplishments on stage and what they did and what they mean to us. Go ahead.
He's very happy for RJ, who graduated last week. That's awesome. Chuck is very proud. Chuck just came here too.
Thank you, Charles Grodin. We appreciate that. We like, think about you all the time.
Because that happened fast.
Yes. Well, Chuck, you are RJ's godfather. So
I forgot about that.
That's just fun that he would stop by to say hi. It was we had a fun time. I filmed it and made a little film for RJ, you know, about his graduation. So
that's great.
You know, celebrating. But, you know, again, this idea, we celebrate those who've crossed over. Right. And we don't have to. I mean, grief is, of course, palpable and real, and people have to go through it in their own way. But we as a group of people spend a lot of time talking about the tragedy and talk about to avoid our own tragic circumstances instead of lauding the kind of work it took to come to the planet and the kind of difficulties they had, whatever it is.
What I just got shown, what actually, I was with Jessica Alba this last week, and we were part of this Sedona group because we went to her birthday in Sedona. And so there's like eight of us, and she put on the thread a book that I've read before. And I'm going to correlate this to some of your books. Like, so it's Dr. Brian Weiss, and some of people might know who he is. He's a very well-known, like his first book, his Many Lives, Many Masters, was actually my first spiritual book that I actually covered with a brown paper bag because I thought my husband might think it's a sex book, or even worse, because Many Lives, Many Masters, or even worse.
Oh, that's a good one.
A spiritual book. And so I would hide it and read it. And I eventually met Brian Weiss, who's fabulous. But this book is called Many Lives, One Soul. And it's a book that he wrote in 2007. I've listened to it before, but it's been many, many years. And so I started listening to it, and it gave me so much comfort, like your divine counsels. Your book on divine counsels gives a lot of people comfort that there's so much more to this life than just what we see or what we feel or just being here. We have guidance from so many different great sources.
Encapsulate a little bit. Dr. Brian Weiss was a Yale psychiatrist working in Miami who had a client who had a psychosomatic illness, and during a regression therapy session recalled a lifetime where that's where the issue came from, and by accessing it the issue went away. So he started to use that as a technique. He's had 4,000 cases since then. And one of them, I'd like to ask you a little bit about this. There is one that he mentioned where he recalled in a second book, it might even be this book you're talking about, where one of his clients recalled a lifetime in Jerusalem, and they saw him there in Jerusalem, saw Dr. Weiss there.
Same soul, many bodies. That's
same soul, many bodies. But in the in this book, the client saw Dr. Weiss at the Via Dolorosa when Jesus was carrying the cross up the steps, okay? And said, but Dr. Weiss, I'm seeing that you were there. Now, Dr. Weiss had never told anybody that he had had a past life regression where he recalled knowing Jesus, talking to Jesus, inviting him over to his home for dinner, and having deep philosophical discussions with Jesus about all kinds of things, which is a whole different way to look at Jesus's journey, as opposed to just being out with the people all the time. This was like an intellectual in Jerusalem, and he was startled and shocked to see what had happened to Jesus. He was being arrested, etc. But his client identified him by the kind of weird piping he had on his toga. It was like orange, and it was very unique. And so now here was a client saying it, and you were there. So I have a question. We talked to Jesus a couple weeks ago, last week, I think. I have a question for Jesus. And let me ask, does Luana want to talk about this now, or she can always change my...
And she put it in your head, even though I'm not...
Okay, very good. All right, let's just put it this way. Can Jesus come forward and have a conversation with us?
She's saying Archangel Michael wants to.
Archangel Michael wants to, but is he going to answer the questions I have for Jesus?
Yeah.
He is. All right.
They're working together.
They're working together. So first things.
I just know that I'm not thinking of Archangel Michael. Let me, just give me a second. I want to make sure I'm getting this right. Archangel Michael has information correlating to what you're going to ask from him.
Okay, very good. All right, thank you.
I can't.
Jennifer has no idea what I'm going to ask. This relates to something that happened to me last week. And so let's just put it this way. I want to ask Jesus about a Roman soldier that assisted him, it did him a favor. And if Michael knows what I'm talking about, because he has the answer, he does. Okay, let's just call that what that is. But first, let's ask, what does Michael look like to you when you're viewing somebody self-identifying as such?
He, just the way he feels, and by Luana, I trust what Luana tells me. So when she says Archangel Michael, I'm going to believe it.
Okay, very good. I just was curious.
For those of you out there, this is very challenging. I have just learned just to go with it. And if I was forcing something, I would have said, Jesus is here. He's right here.
Do you know what I mean? I know what you're saying.
So I'm getting that Archangel Michael, for whatever reason, we need to speak to him about this situation with a Roman soldier.
And I have been working with Jennifer for 8 years weekly. And I've come to see that I can just ask a very specific question that she doesn't know anything about, and she will give her best interpretation of what she's getting directly. And so we're not going to chastise you for saying that Michael's here. I've talked to him, quote unquote, through other people, and he's, he self-identifies as an archangel as opposed to a regular angel. Let's just put it that way. But here's my question. This Roman soldier that did Jesus a favor, how accurate is that story that I heard last week?
He's saying it's not completely accurate. He says that he's telling, so give me a second.
Okay, please. And I have no desire for it to be accurate or inaccurate.
No, I know that.
So I just want you to know that, yeah.
Why? Because it feels like it's different. He says that the Roman soldier, just give me a second. So did this Roman soldier do something to Jesus? Is that what
did a favor for him.
He says he did something that he helped him more than what he's telling. So it's even more so. So that's why it's not as accurate.
Even more than the word favor, a bigger than the favor. Is that what he means?
Right. And he's showing me that that was decided a long time. Like
that was decided before the favor was granted. Is that correct?
Right.
Okay. And decided by who? Decided by their friends and compatriots, or by somebody off planet, you know, off stage?
All of the above.
All of the above. Okay. They sort of work together on it. And listen, let me ask this simple question. Can you give Jennifer the name of this soldier, if he had a name, as best you can? And it, just the sound of the name, doesn't have to be spelling.
It's interesting because it almost feels like something like Constantine or something that's, you know, I got Saul for one thing, and then I came back to something that, I just, give me a second. It wasn't Constantine, but why did you show me Constantine? Okay. I'm still so confused.
Well, let me, if I may, was his name was Saul, and was the cohort or legion that he was in something to do with Constantine?
Yes.
Okay. I'm trying to translate what I'm getting.
Well, so, I was getting that, but then I'm like, under Constantine's rule? Like, I'm still...
Yeah, no, I understand. It would be like a you know, part of the legion. It's something I can look up. So what happened to this fella? Do you want to show it to Jennifer, or do you want me to be specific about what we're talking about? Oh, Jennifer just saw that I'm talking about. Go ahead. What are you seeing?
He was killed.
He was killed. And how was he killed? Just give you a visual.
My visual was an arrow through the heart.
An arrow through the heart. Okay. And was he standing, sitting?
He's walking.
Walking. And who did him in?
Somebody from Constantine's.
So another soldier.
Yeah.
Okay.
He died after leaving. So I don't know if he left Jesus and then died or whatever it was.
Okay. After leaving, that would imply something about after he did this favor that he, so Michael, this is important to me, maybe not so much to our listeners, but would you show Jennifer what the favor was that this soldier, Saul, did for Jesus, somebody that
felt like it was some type of escape route.
Escaping. Okay. Some kind of a way, means of escape.
Well, I don't know if that.
Let me ask, did they switch places in any way? That's my question.
Yeah, that's it.
They switched places.
Well, okay. They just went like this.
You went like that. That's correct.
I have no idea.
All right, I know you don't. That's why I'm asking it this way. Did they switch places before he was tortured and put on the cross, or after?
After. That's what it feels like.
Okay. All right. Well, that puts a different spin on why I'm asking this question. So he did this.
Wait a second.
Go ahead.
After.
So
like it looks like he was replaced in the tomb.
So in other words, he was in the tomb. Jesus was there.
He bought time for something like that.
He bought time for him.
Yeah.
I heard this unusual story that there was a fella that switched places with Jesus at some point in his ordeal. And that's what I'm trying to get to the heart of. Did they switch him out before Jesus went on the cross and Saul went on the cross instead?
Everything that I'm getting feels like something was done in the tomb after.
After. Okay, very good. No, and that clarifies things because, you know, I've had people tell me the story. And if that's the case, then that kind of makes sense. But did he get wounded in his own way and so they could substitute him, or he just looked like him?
He just looked like him.
Okay. This is what I heard, that there was a Roman soldier who looked so much like Jesus, and he was a follower of Jesus, that he did this favor of switching places.
He offered to switch places.
He offered to switch places.
Jesus wouldn't do it.
So the ordeal that Jesus went through was the ordeal that Jesus went through. Anyway, that's the question. So, Michael, what else do you want to talk about, Michael, that I have you? That can't be the only question I ask you.
The reason why he came through versus Jesus is because he was there when this happened. And it was just a different take, you know. I don't know. That was interesting. This is about Jesus.
Right. His perspective is different. So let me ask you, Michael, is my account that's in the book, The Greatest Story Never Told, as told by Jesus and those who knew him. Is it accurate?
98% accurate.
It's what?
98% accurate.
90% or 98%?
98.
98. I'm just trying. Can I put that on the cover of the book? Michael says. All right. Well, Luana, I know we don't have a lot of time with Jennifer. I want to bring it back to you. That was my personal question. Had to do with my book. Lou, what do you want to focus on? Thank you, Michael. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you for Jesus for bringing Michael.
Yes.
Luana, back to you. Who do you want? Else do you want us to talk about or consider?
We wanted to talk about RJ and how New York is going to be waiting for him in some capacity. Yeah.
RJ in New York. Okay, my son, who just graduated high school, he talked about maybe going to NYU. Got to get in. But oh, that's interesting. And what occupation are we talking about? You know,
musician. I mean, I feel a musician.
Musician. Okay, he was talking about that.
But like a composer.
That's exactly what he was talking about the other day. It kind of came to him.
I feel like he's going to be a great composer from what I'm picking up on from Luana. Luana's so,
my mom, the concert pianist.
Whose anniversary is it that's coming up?
Mom's birthday at the end of this month, Auntie.
Oh.
End of next month, I forget.
They're saying happy birthday to me.
Happy birthday to you. That's right. Your birthday's coming up. Very good. Listen, okay. You know, when your child graduates, and I'm sure Jennifer has gone through this with both her beautiful children, and every parent does, you know, what do you want to do? And you can't really ask the question because you know it's whatever it is they're going to do is the right thing. So in his case, though, just the other day, started talking about like Hans Zimmer, what he does, composing music for movies.
Yeah. And composer, like a very intricate composer.
Interesting. Yeah. Interesting. Well, that's great. I mean, that's something he loved to do. Jennifer, you've never heard him play the piano?
I did the other day.
I posted him doing the theme from Succession.
Succession.
Which he didn't read. He just heard it and played it. He's pretty good at that.
She said the apple, but I think it came from your mom.
Yeah, it bypassed me. I could play the theme song of our show, but
they're very excited for Sherry as well.
Say again?
I'm very excited for Sherry. Like she's just diving into, she's just doing really well, they're saying.
In terms of her sort of focus?
Yeah, in terms of her focus.
That's very good and very interesting.
She had a big breakthrough, it feels like, a couple of weeks ago.
Okay, and I don't really want to go deeply into it, but today they announced that they might have found the remains of my old pal, Julian Sands, up in the mountains. Wow. And my wife, Sherry, had a very profound, because she met him, and we had dinner with him, and she had a very profound message from him back in January. And I forwarded it on to his to people who can send it to his family. And I won't say what it is, but I'll just say that it was very profound, very moving, and it appears to be kind of accurate. So, but she asked me not to talk about it. Other than, you know, if Julian wanted to come through, of course. Julian, do you want to stop by and say hi?
Well, he said back then, he said that we said that it wouldn't be found, he wouldn't be found until about now.
Yeah, you did. That's right. We did say that.
So he's just mentioning it. We told you.
So, Julian, what would you like?
Remember that I'm not there. It's just my body, but I'm not there. Don't go through more grief, he's saying. He's like, I'm doing great. I'm having a lot of fun over here. What?
Well, tell us about it. What's it like for you?
Kilimanjaro. He's climbing Kilimanjaro.
Sorry?
He's climbing Kilimanjaro?
He's climbing Kilimanjaro. He loved the mountains. He loved to be out climbing mountains.
Well, I think that's how he passed. I'm not saying, but he's
No, but in life he did. And that's kind of, I think, what he's still experiencing, which is that what it's like to climb mountains.
Yeah. Oh, he adores you, Richard. He hears you when you talk to him. And he says, thank you.
That's very sweet.
He says he gets you to go climbing in your dreams.
I have climbed. I've been up to Mount Kailash. We know that. And I wondered if I was going to make it around that mountain. But Julian, anything you want to say to your friends and fans?
He says, please know I would do that any day, all day. That's just me. He goes, it was unfortunate how, with what happened, it felt like he slept. It was unfortunate, but I'd do it all over again. So just know that it's not something that he's just like, keep climbing. Like everyone, just keep climbing.
And so just if you could give us a little of your experience, who greeted you on the other side?
That's so interesting. He showed me this big bear greeted him. And I guess when he was younger, there was some exchange between a bear when he was hiking or something along those lines. The bear almost got him. That's what it feels like. Like, was it scary at first to see a bear when you like leave this planet? And he goes, yeah, I didn't know where I was. But
And so at what point did you realize where you were?
And the bear started talking to him, telling him.
And what, I'm sorry. And what did the bear have to say? What did he try to tell you? Or what did he say to you?
He said, he must have died before he did. He's like, it's time to go. That's what he said.
So basically, almost like a spirit guide showing up to say, now is the time to come back. I know that Native Americans consider bears as spirit animals, and buffalo and stuff like that. Yeah. Fascinating.
Spirit animals are amazing. They are absolutely wonderful to connect to.
So, and who are you hanging out, if I might ask, with? Are you hanging out with anybody, or?
Bill Paxton right now, because he's up there.
Very cool.
There's so many different old, like, Hollywood people, it feels like.
Old friends. Or some, yeah. Anyone you were surprised to see?
Oh my gosh. Who? Give me 1 second. Oh, Aretha Franklin. He was surprised to see her.
The queen.
Yeah. And of course, Elvis. But he goes, it's definitely a surprise, but it's also, again, there's no hierarchy. So it wasn't like it was just like, oh, okay. This is how it works.
Right. This is how it works. I would be neglectful. I didn't ask any messages for Evgenia, your wife, or your 3 kids.
He says, I love them. He says he visits each one of them.
Oh, and did one of them recognize that you had visited them just afterwards? Because I think that was part of the message.
Yeah. One of them also, I think, is a climber. I'm not sure, but he's just saying, don't stop because of what happened to me. Like, follow your dreams, like follow whatever you're passionate about. And he shows me, like, in every sport and everywhere, like I'm going diving can be dangerous, right? You just have to figure out, because like every sport is dangerous. And he's showing me football, he's showing me, you know, it's, you just have to, sometimes you make it, sometimes you don't, you know. It sounds like a Kit Kat commercial or a Snickers commercial.
But follow your passion, follow your heart.
Follow your heart. Yeah, he's very close to his family. He's definitely visiting them.
That's very good. I hope that somebody passes.
Especially his wife. Well, now she's going to have closure, but maybe now the healing can begin.
That's great.
Yeah.
Very good.
All right. I have to get going.
I know you have to go. Well, thank you so much, everybody. Thank you, Jennifer. Thank you, Luana. Thank you, Julian. Thanks, Michael, for stepping in, for answering our questions to the J-Man. And thank you, Billy Paxton. You know, you're always welcome, and you always make us laugh. And we love hearing from you.
Now that I know his name.
And we love thinking about you, just because thinking about you does make us laugh. Thanks. Yeah. Thanks, everybody. We love you. Love you, Jennifer.
Bye. Love you.
This has been Hacking the Afterlife podcast with Jennifer Schaefer. For more information, jenniferschaefer.com, martinizone.com, or richmartini.com. Hacking the Afterlife documentary is available on Gaia.com via Amazon Prime.